joy to thee, O Queen of Heaven. Alleluia. Whom thou wast meet to bear. Alleluia. As he promised,
rejoice and be glad, O Virgin Mary. Alleluia. For the Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Let us pray. O God, who through the resurrection of thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, is vouchsafed to give joy to the whole world, grant, we beseech thee, that through his mother, the Virgin Mary, we may obtain the joys of everlasting life, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, amen. In tua voluntate Dei, et nec glorificati un totum eum. Iuri camere sergium causum eum legendam non sanctam, haumen en elenco de los orome. Quietus Deus fortitudum eum, quare replicis, quare tristis in cielo tuum infligem in vicus. Emite lucem tuum libertatum tuum, ipsum et denuncia non trudux erot imontum sanctum tuum, et un ancora tua. Et in tua voluntate Dei, et nec glorificati un totum eum. Confite ut in incitura, Deus, Deus, meus, coi tristis anima mea, ut quare contubas me. Sperin Deo, quam arconio mat hoc compitevo ini, salutari vultus me, et Deus meus. Gloria Patri, Filio, Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. In tua voluntate Dei, et in glorificari un tutum eum. Auditorium nostrum in nomine Domini, qui feci caelum et terra. Confiti, o Demipotenti, via di Maria, se Virgine, via di Italia, Tangelo, via di Guardo, Pista, e Santi, Vossi, Svetri, Paolo, via di Guardo, Maria, di Anni, o Musanti, tuo Visuafes, qui è vita, vini, mi scogitazione, ve vuoi t'offre, ne ho culpa, mea maxima culpa, e ne ho prego, e altra Maria, se Virgine, via di Italia, ma Tangelo, ve altra mia, o Pista, Santos, Vossi, Svetri, Paolo, ve altra mia, o Maria, di Anni, o ne Santos, Vossfates, ora le promette, dono del nostro. Miseria a tutti i miei potenze, visto i miei sfruttati, sui sfrutta e te, vita eterna. Amen. Confiti, o Deo onnipotenti, beate Maria sempre vigini, beato Michele Arcangelo, beato Ioanni Battista, Sanctis Apostis Petro e Paolo, omnibus Sanctis et Divi Pater, quia peccavi nimis cogitazione, verbo et opere, meo culpa, meo culpa, meo maxima culpa. Ileo prego beata Mariam sempre Virginem, beatum Michaelum Arcangelum, beatum Ioannem Baptistam, Sanctus Apostolus Petrus Paulum, omnes Sanctos et te Pater, orare pro me, ad Dominum Deum nostrum. Miseriato vestimi potens Deus, et mis peccatis vestis, veduca et vosse vitam aeternam. Amen. In urgentia me sussiore, me fremissione, peccatorum nostrum orum tibi, et nomis omnipotens misericus Dominus. Amen. Deus tu versus perfidicabis nas, et plebs tu electabitor in te, ostende nobis Domine misericordiam tuam, et salutare tuum da nobis, Domine exaudi l'actione mea, et clamum es et te veniat, Dominus vobiscum, et cum spirito tuo, orlebus. In medio ecclesiae perruitus eius, et in plebit eum Dominus spiritus sapiens et intellectus, stolam glorie induiteum, alleluia, alleluia. Bonum est conviteri Domino, et sedere in nomine tua altissime. Gloria Patri, Filio, Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. In medio ecclesiae perruitus eius, et in plebit eum Dominus spiritus sapiens et intellectus, stolam glorie induiteum, alleluia, alleluia. Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Christe eleison, Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison, Kyrie eleison. Gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra pax hominibus bone voluntatis, laudamus te, benedicimus te, adoramus te, glorificamus te. Gratias agimus tibi pro te mandam gloriam tuam, Domine Deus, Rex Celestis, Deus Pater Omnipotens, Domine Filiuni Genita Jesu Christe, Domine Deus, Agnus Dei, Filius Patris, qui talis peccatum mundi miserere nobis, qui talis peccatum mundi suscipe deputationem nostram, qui seres et extram patris miserere nobis. Voniam tu solus sanctus, tu solus dominus, tu solus altissimus Jesu Christe, cum sanctu spiritu in gloria Dei Patris. Amen. Ex vobis, et cum spirito tuo. Oremus. Exaudi caesimus Domini preces nostras, quas inviatsi Athanasii confessoris tui atque pontifici solennitati deferimus, et qui tibi digni meruit famulari eius intercedensibus meritis, ab omnibus nos absolve peccatis. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Lex epistole viati Pauli Apostoli et Corinthios. Fratres, nos et ipsos predicamus, sed Iesum Christum Dominum nostrum, nos autem servos vestros per Iesum. Quoniam Deus, qui dixit de tenebris lucem splendescere, ipse illucit in corpibus nostris ad illuminationem scientiae claritatis Dei, in facie Christi Iesu. Habemus autem tau sorum istum in vasis fictilibus, ut sublimitas sit vetutis Dei et non ex nobis. In omnibus tribulationem patimur, sed non angustiamur, aporiamur, sed non distruimur, persecutionem patimur, sed non delinquimur, dicemur, sed non perimus, semper mortificationem Iesu incorpore nostro circumferentes, ut et vita Iesu manifestetur in corporibus nostris. Semper enim nos, qui vivimus in mortem tradimo prote Iesum, ut et vita Iesu manifestetur in carne nostre mortali. Ergo mors in nobis operatur vita autem in vobis. Habentes autem euntem spiritum de fidei, sicut scriptum est, credidi prote quo locutus sum, et nos credimus prote quo deloquimur, scientes quoniam qui suscitavit Iesum, et nos cum Iesu suscitabit et constituit vobiscum. Deo gratias. Alleluia, alleluia. Tu esse scedos in aeternum secundum ordine Melchisedec. Alleluia. Beatus vir qui surfet tentationem, quoniam cum probatus suverit, accipiet coronam vitae. Alleluia. Nominus vobiscum et cum spirito tuo. Sequentia Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum, gloria tibi Domine. In illo tempore dixit Iesus discipulis suis, cum persecuntur vos civitati ista, fugite in aliam. A mendico vobis, non possum habitis civitas Israel, non et veniat filius hominis. Non est discipulus suum, nec servus super Dominum suum. Suffici discipulo ut sit, sicut magister eius, et servus sicut dominus eius. Si patrem familias Beelzebub vocaferunt, quantum magis domesticos eius? Ne ergo timueritis eius, nihil enim eis opetum, quod non revelabitur, et occultum quod non scetur. Quod digo vobis in tenebris, dicite in lumine, et quod in aurea auditis, predicate super tecta. Et non ite timere, eius qui occidunt corpus, anima mautem non possunt occidere, sed potius timete eum qui potest et animam et corpus perdere in Gehenna. Laus, tibi Christi. On this, the feast of Saint Athanasius of Alexandria, Bishop and Doctor of the Church. The epistle is taken from the second letter of St. Paul the Apostle to the Church at Corinth. Brethren, it is not ourselves we proclaim. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. The same God who made light shine out of darkness has kindled a light in our hearts, whose shining is to make known his glory as he has revealed it in the features of Jesus Christ. We have a treasure then in our keeping, but it shall is of perishable earthenware. It must be God and not anything in ourselves that gives it its sovereign power. For ourselves we are being hampered everywhere, yet still have room to breathe, our heart put to it, but never at a loss. Persecution does not leave us unbefriended, nor crushing blows destroy us. We carry about continually in our bodies the dying state of Jesus, so that the living power of Jesus may be manifested in our bodies too. Always, we are always alive as we are being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life-giving power of Jesus may be manifested in this mortal nature of ours. So death makes itself felt in us, and life in you. I spoke my mind, says the scripture, with full confidence, and we too speak our minds with full confidence, sharing that same faith, and knowing that he who raised Jesus from the dead will raise us too with Jesus, and summon us like you before him. And the Holy Gospel is the continuation of that according to St. Matthew. At this time Jesus said to his disciples, "If they persecute you in one city, take refuge in another. I promise you the Son of Man will come before your task with the cities of Israel is ended. A disciple is no better than his master, a servant than his Lord. Enough that the disciple should fare like his master, the servant like his Lord. If they have cried Beelzebub and the master of the house, they will do it much more readily to the men of his household. Do not then be afraid of them. What is veiled will all be revealed. What is hidden will all be known. What I have said to you under cover of darkness, you are to utter in the light of day. What has been whispered in your ears, you are to proclaim on the housetops. And there is no need to fear those who kill the body, but have no..." Ave Maria, gratia plena Dominus tecum, benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus. Sancta Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostrae. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Charissimi, beloved in Christ, welcome to this broadcast mass. I'm sorry for the Wi-Fi clearly is playing up this afternoon. I apologize for interruptions. If I note them, I will try and pause. I have another screen as a kind of monitor, and it tells me when the broadcast is interrupted. So when that happens, I pause and wait for it to come back again. I just hope that it does come back. Anyway, welcome to this broadcast mass. On this, the feast of Saint Athanasius, Bishop of Alexandria. Now, he was born, we think, sometime before the end of the 3rd century and at the turn of the 4th century. So literally during the time of persecution of whose saints we have been recalling these past couple of weeks, Remember, St. George was martyred in 303 AD. So St. Athanasius was a wee babe, a wee child, during that period, the greatest period then in the early church of persecution. And that may explain why he later, in his considerable writings, makes very little reference to that period of persecution. There was at one time a suggestion that he was maybe born a decade earlier, in which case he would have noticed and lived through that period of persecution. But the fact that he barely references it in any of his writings rather suggests that he wasn't aware of it. The suggestion being that if he had been about the age of 10 or a young teenager, he would certainly have known about the persecution and written about it, as it would clearly, of course, have influenced his upbringing. But as it is, most scholars now think he was born around 296 to 298 AD, and so therefore would have been a very young child during the persecutions under Diocletian. Though, of course, the church wasn't really freed from persecution until the ascendancy of Constantine. So for much of his life, his early life, St. Athanasius, of course, would have experienced and known something of the persecutions of the church, perhaps in other places of the world. Alexandria, by this time, had become something of a socio-economic centre for the eastern part of the empire, or we might say the southeastern part of the empire. And Alexandria itself was a very cosmopolitan, or even a very cosmopolitan city. Famous, of course, for the lighthouse of Pharos, there at the entrance to the harbour, one of the great wonders of the world, one of the great seven wonders of the world. And of course, for its great library, which still at that time existed. And Athanasius, of course, then benefited from growing up in such a cosmopolitan atmosphere, such that we know he spoke at least two or three languages, and he was extremely well read. Though his parents were Christians, he received a secular education in rhetoric and grammar, which today we would refer to as kind of the classical subjects of the humanities. There he excelled as a scholar. We don't think, however, that his parents were of nobility, but perhaps of perhaps higher-ranking merchant class, such that they could afford to send Athanasius to receive such a good education as he had. It's a lovely story is told of when he was a boy playing baptism with friends in the sea, and how Bishop Alexander happened to be passing and noted these boys playing baptism, and called them to him and asked who the ringleader was. The ringleader, of course, was Athanasius, who was surprised then to learn from the bishop that all those baptisms were valid, and that in which case he and his playmates perhaps ought to think about seriously dedicating their lives to God and his service. And that perhaps was the spark of the realization of the vocation in Athanasius to become a sacred minister. Certainly Bishop Alexander continued then to be a mentor. Eventually, of course, Athanasius would succeed Alexander as Bishop of Alexandria. He wrote two of his greatest works before the age, or around the age of 20. Certainly by 319 he had written his famous treatise Against the Heresies concerning the incarnation of Christ. This was not yet then an apologetic against Arianism, which of course would feature largely later in Athanasius' life. Indeed, not that very much later. For of course, in 325 at Nicea, Constantine called a great council because of the new heresy of Arius concerning the nature of Christ. For those of you who perhaps have forgotten what the Arian heresy was, it was the suggestion that Christ was not co-eternal with God, but rather as Son of God was a creature rather than a divine being. Or that is to say that he was created rather than uncreated. At this stage, Arius had only a few followers, and he had Bishop Alexander, Athanasius's mentor, had tried to reconcile with Arius. Indeed, he gave Arius one of the larger, most affluent parishes in the city of Alexandria, but seemingly this was only to last a little while. That was in 311 or 312 AD. By the time of 318, 319, Arius was widely arguing, publicly arguing with Bishop Alexander again. Anyway, in 325, Constantine calls this great council. Bishops from all over the world descend on a chair near Constantinople. Then, of course, a new city being constructed. There they discuss and eventually lay down the creed and settle the question of the nature of Christ as being both human and divine, and of his being co-eternal with God, consubstantial, as we say in the creed. However, later on, after Constantine's death, trials and tribulations would come upon the church, and the Arian heresy would raise its head, though not this time because of Arius, who himself died in about 333, but rather through one of those few bishops who had been a supporter of his, Eusebius of Nicomedia. Eusebius, though he had been exiled, as had Arius, after the council in Nicea for his heresy, nonetheless retained lots of contacts in the imperial court. Indeed, he was a distant relation of the Emperor Constantine. So that when Constantine's successors, who variously apostatized, becoming Arians or pagans, this was largely under the influence of Eusebius, who had been, as it were, clugging away at them in the background, sowing through his embittered sense of loss, this perpetuating this heresy. By this time, Alexander had died, and Athanasius had succeeded him as bishop of Alexandria. And then Athanasius, of course, became the great defender of orthodoxy. Now, there is a wonderful phrase in Latin that really sums up for us today's saint, and I hope that we might deem ourselves to strive to have that motto describe as ourselves, that motto, not motto really, but that epithet might become a motto for ourselves. Athanasius contra mundum, Athanasius against the world, because indeed at one point it seemed to Athanasius at one point that the whole of the church, all of the world, the whole empire had come under the influence of Arianism, under the influence of heresy. And poor Athanasius, who suffered, though he didn't die a martyr, certainly his life, through his life he experienced martyrdom for his defence of orthodoxy. It's amazing how in such a short period of time, relatively speaking, from 325, when orthodoxy was affirmed at the Great Council of Nicaea, within just 20 or 30 years, suddenly the world had become Arian. So he became one of the few voices defending the Orthodox faith, and he suffered greatly for that. But that phrase, Athanasius contra mundum,
is a phrase, my brothers and sisters, that in many ways encapsulates the nature of our faith being itself so contrary to the thinking of the world. How many times do we hear in Scripture our Lord making the point that the world will not appreciate his teaching, the world will not appreciate our faith? That's why in today's gospel we heard him saying to the apostles and disciples, if they persecute the master, how much more then will they persecute the servants? And likewise from St. Paul in his letter to the Corinthians, and as of course we've heard in the letter to Timothy most of this week, St. Paul himself of course endured persecution and said that those who follow Christ genuinely will experience persecution. And of course, my brothers and sisters, this is because we living here as Christians are citizens of heaven, and we should be thinking in the way of citizens of heaven, not consumed and possessed and obsessive about material things and creature comforts, but rather, of course, recognizing that this experience, this life as it is not as God had intended it. And that it is only by enduring through this life, sanctifying ourselves, fitting ourselves for heaven, that we may play our part in the realization of the restoration of creation and the reconciliation of God with creatures at the end of time. This is why our Lord says, the kingdom of God is in you, not here, not there, but in you. And that's why we pray. Remember, he taught us to pray, thy kingdom come. Because contrary to what some modern theologians like to try to suggest, the kingdom of God has not yet come. The kingdom of God will come when Christ himself returns. Until that time, the kingdom of God is in those who are citizens of heaven, which of course we are by virtue of our baptism, by our consecration, our blessing, our being set apart for God as his chosen people. Thus, our experience, our life, as it were, on earth changes from being self-centered and selfish and all about self-survival to becoming mirrors of God, who is love, sacrificial love. Selflessness becomes then the purpose of our lives. Sacrificial living, sacrificial giving, sacrificial stewardship of the material world. Realizing in us that vocation first given to humanity, represented in Adam, to be a steward of the things of creation and to be a partner with God, to be a collaborator with God. Indeed, we may understand that what God desires for each and every one of us is to realize with him, both in this life and in the next, that vocation which he first gave to Adam. That he wants us to walk with him. Just as he and Adam walked in the Garden of Eden, so God wants, as it were, us to walk with him now and forever. And we can experience this now if we fit our lives according to that pattern which God desires for us and which is revealed to us, divinely revealed to us, in Scripture and in the teachings of Jesus. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, as Christians, we should be conforming ourselves, our lives, to the dictates and teachings of the Scriptures and not the principles and priorities and thinking of the world around us. This is what is meant by us being countercultural. Now, the most radical expression of it, of course, is seen in the Anchorites and the Hermits, which, of course, Athanasius was a great proponent and expositor of the life and example of people like St. Anthony of Egypt. They are, of course, they manifest the most radical realization of the evangelical counsels of poverty, chastity, and obedience, of forsaking the world and living only for God and no other. But as we've reflected before, not all of us are called necessarily to that radical realization. However, we are all of us called to live as citizens of heaven, though we live in the world. And that means our priorities then, our attitude, our approach must be different. And key to understanding that is to realizing and accepting, as I said in a conference the other day, that our lives are not our own. When we receive baptism, we acknowledge and recognize that our lives come from God. Our lives are purposed by God. Our lives only exist for God's purpose. And it is the purpose of our lives to realize His will for our lives. Our lives are not our own. That really is a fundamental precept, my brothers and sisters, that we as Christians ought strive always to remember. Which is why we should live sacrificially for each other. Live sacrificially for God and live sacrificially for each other. Seeking always to do His will. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Again, our Saviour teaches us to pray that. And as we've reflected before, in order for us to realise that, we need to pursue holiness. We need to be actively trying to be holy. And of course, my brothers and sisters, there are those whom we live with. There are family, there are friends, there are work colleagues. There are people who will say, oh, look at you trying to be all holier than thou. And they will mock us and they will jeer us. They will insult us. Because they can see that the priority of our life, the attitude and the approach of our lives is different to theirs. And it makes them uncomfortable. Why does it make them uncomfortable? Because fundamentally, of course, though they sometimes but yet haven't realised it, they recognise that in our striving for holiness, in our pursuit of righteousness, we are living sacrificially. And they are living selfishly. You know, the world, my brothers and sisters, is a selfish world. The contemporary zeitgeist is extremely selfish. It's all about me, myself, and I. It's all about what I think, what I want, what I'm entitled to. Seriously, my brothers and sisters, recently, of course, it has all become about entitlement. The truth of the matter is, no one is entitled to anything in this life. The only thing they are entitled to is knowing God, is knowing God's love. They are entitled to serve Him, and they are entitled to be happy with Him. Those, my brothers and sisters, which you will recognize from the Penny Catechism as the reason why we exist. Those four reasons are the only things that we are entitled to. Everything else essentially is of God's gift, of God's divine providence. If there's one thing coronavirus, I hope, has taught to the world, is some humility. There are those, of course, who say, oh, well, in fact, there's a meme going around Facebook ascribing to Mother Nature the suggestion that she can survive without us. And as I've told you, my brothers and sisters, before, A, of course, there's no such thing as Mother Nature, forget that, but B, that meme otherwise is absolutely right. Because humanity is separate, distinct from the rest of creation. It's true. If all of humanity was wiped out today, nature would still live on. Creation would still live on. The birds and the bees and the flowers and the trees, they would all still grow. And yes, if anything, probably better off without us. Except, of course, the chaos would follow. Everything will become untidy. They would, even amongst themselves, the creatures of creation would begin to battle and vie for life and existence. Those of you who are gardeners, you will know that if you don't, for example, trim certain types of plants, etc., they will grow exponentially and take over wherever they're planted. You know, anyone who knows anything about mint will know that unless you plant mint in some kind of container, and even then it's not guaranteed, it will take over the area where you've planted it. But the same is true of all created beings. The same is true of other types of plants and vegetables, fruit, trees, and indeed the same with animals. Animals will continue to fight and kill each other for food. All of that will carry on and would happen without us. And there you see, I hope, why humanity's role and purpose is as God's collaborator, is to bring order to this chaos, is to tend to creation, to enable the mutual flourishing of all that is in it. That's why the analogy of humanity as a gardener in terms of our stewardship of the earth's resources is so apt. Our role here on earth is essentially to be partners and collaborators with God, to tend to creation, to care for creation, not to selfishly destroy it, not to rob it of all its worth for our own selfish interests. There is much, my brothers and sisters, about, for example, the environmental and ecological movement that has some basis, some place in sound thinking and theology. For sure, we should, all of us, be good stewards of creation. We should not be exploiting the world's resources for our own selfish interests. But we should be about utilizing and sharing them for the mutual flourishing of all creation, not just humanity, but of all creation. In other words, to try and realize, as it were, some sense of balance and harmony, to bring some order to creation. Because remember, creation as it is now is not as it was, nor as it shall be, and is not as God had intended it to be. The argument that so many give to justify all sorts of things, oh, it's only natural, is no argument at all, theologically. Because creation is not as God had intended it to be. Because of the fall. When God, yes, created everything, initially it was perfect. God saw that it was good. But after the fall, it was corrupted. It became diseased. Death came into the world through sin. That's why everything dies. Everything. Oh, I know there is a species of frog that lives in the ice and can live for maybe 1,000 years, having a really low metabolic rate and at a pulse that is barely perceptible without ingenious instruments to record it. But they do eventually die. Yes, I know there are species of shark in the frozen oceans of the north that likewise can live for 500 years. But they do eventually die. Everything in this life eventually dies. And that's because it is corrupted, because it is diseased. Which is why we, my brothers and sisters, owe. Why we owe a duty of care. Why we owe a sense of vocation and responsibility to care for and look after the world around us. And for each other. Yes, to care for each other, but also to care for the world around us for each other. But you see, my brothers and sisters, this stark difference between the reality that we know, the truth that we know because we see with the eyes of faith, and what the rest of the world thinks. Left to their own devices, they're all out for themselves. Look at humanity. See how that appeal to nature appeals only to the corrupted expression and form of nature. How humans, when they do that, become like animals. All they become concerned about is their own selfish interests. All that drives them is their own self-survival. And they will kill and kill and kill for their own sake. Just as the wild animals do. But when we use that gift that has been given to us by God, as part of our created order, that thing that distinguishes us, that separates us from the rest of creation, what is it? But it is that free will, and it is that ability, that higher intellectual ability to rationalize, to reason, to think outside the limitations and constraints of our existence and our experience. It's why we can force ourselves not to do things. That's why we can stop ourselves from doing things. And the scriptures teach us how to have that self-control, urge us to employ that self-control, again, to avoid that chaos. Because the world, left to its own devices, would destroy itself. And we're at a stage now where humanity itself is destroying itself, even before the rest of creation. So self-obsessed and possessed and consumed as humanity become. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, this epithet, Athanasius contra mundum, should become our own. Should become our own motto. It should become Darren contra mundum. It should become Shirley contra mundum. It should become Adrian contra mundum. Barbara contra mundum. Hieronymus contra mundum. Every Christian, as it were, should be against the world. And that doesn't mean to hate the world. That doesn't mean to despise the world. Rather, that means to strive through sacrificial love and care, compassion, teaching, to enable the rest of the world to realize the truth that we know and understand and that will save them. Save them by enabling them to realize for themselves God's plan and work of redemption. Remember, my brothers and sisters, that everything can be used for God's will. Everything can be reordered to be used for God's will, to express and to manifest God's will, to bring about God's will. There's no need for us to despise the material. The whole point of our incarnational faith is about hallowing the material and about bringing it back to right order. So, as I say, use the tool that is the internet. Research St. Athanasius, read about his life and his testimony and his witness, and be inspired yourselves to follow his example and to stand by steadfastly that which is right, that which is righteous, that which is holy, that which is true, that which ultimately will enable us to realize, and others in this life, the right way in which we should be living and experiencing all that this created order has to offer. In the right way, in God's way. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father. God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, spoke by the prophets, and I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world.
Dominus suaviscum et cum spirito tuo.
Ardemus.
In veni David servum meum, oleus sanctum meum sieum, manus eni meo zeliabitur et brachium meum covotabit eum.
Alleluia.
Thank you.
saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Dominus vobiscum, et cum spirito tuo, sus in corda, habemus ad Dominum, gratias damus, Domino Deo nostro, dignum et justum est, emere dignum et justum est, equam salutare, te quidem Domini omni tempore, sed in hoc potissimum gloriosius predicare, cum pasca nostrum immolatus est Christus, imse enim veros es agnus, qui absolit peccato mundi, qui mortem nostram oriendo destruxit, et vitam resurgendo recorrabit, et ideo cum angelis et arcangelis controlis et dominationibus conque omnium nisa celestis exercitus, in nom gloriae tuae canimus sine fine dicentes. Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus, Sabaoth, plenis in celi et terra gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis. Benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini, Hosanna in excelsis.
obiettivo obbligatorio. Verum ia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Orde, prece di salutaribus maledite venis lotiane formati. Avemus digene. Ad noster quae sinceri sanctificetur novum tuum, veniat regum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo, et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris. Et ne nos inducas in tentationem, se libra nossa mano. Ferrum ia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Mansa Domini sit semper vobiscum, et cum spirito tuo. Agnus Dei, qui talis peccatum mundi miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui talis peccatum mundi miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui talis peccatum mundi dona nobis pace. Domine non sum dignus. Domine non sum dignus. Ecce agnus Dei, ecce qui tollit peccato mundi. Domine, non sum dignus ut intre sub tectum meum, sed tandem dic verbo et sennabitur anima mea. Domine, non sum dignus ut intre sub tectum meum, sed tandem dic verbo et sennabitur anima mea. Domine, non sum dignus ut intre sub tectum meum, sed tandem dic verbo et sennabitur anima mea. Brothers and sisters watching Mass online and unable therefore to receive the Blessed Sacrament, we invite you now to make an act of spiritual communion.
My Jesus, I believe that thou art present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love thee above all things, and I desire thee in my soul. Since I cannot now receive thee sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though thou wert already there, I embrace thee and unite myself wholly to thee. Permit not that I should ever be separated from thee. Amen. In auri auditis predicati super tecta. Alleluia. Dominus vobiscum et cum spirito tuo. Guardemus. Decus fidelium rem honorator animarum presta, ut beati Athanasii confessoris tui atque pontificis, cuius venerandum celebramus festivitatem, regibus indulgentiam consequatur. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum, Filium tuum, et tecum viuda regna ad unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus,
ferrum ia saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Dominus vobiscum, et cum spirito tuo, ide misa est, Deo gratias.
Sed nomen Domini benedictum, es oblunque dusque in saecula, auditorium nostrum in nomine Domini, qui feci caelum et terram, benedicat vos omnipotens Deus.
Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen.
Dominus vobiscum, et cum spirito tuo, initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem, gloria tibi Domine.
In principio erat verbum, et verbum erat campo Deum, et Deus erat verbum, hoc erat in principio factum Deum. Omnium principum factum sum, et essentia factum est nihil, vel factum est. In ipso vita erat lux omnium, lux in tenebris luce, et tenebra eam non comprehenderunt. Fuit homo vestus in loco nomen oratio agnes, sic venit id testimoni, mo testimoni beberit lumen et omnes credere in quibu. Non erit in lux, sed ut testimoni beberit lumen, erat lux vere, quae lumen ad omnem hominem venientim in hoc mundum. In mundo erat, unus scriptum factus est, unus non cognovit, in propria venit in sonore ceperunt. Corpora altem ceperunt, eam de solistatum filius Dei fieri his vi credi nomine eius. Qui non sanguinibus, nec voluntatic agnis, nec voluntatic viri, sed ex Deo nati sunt. Et verbum caro factum est, et habitavit in nomis infinimus gloria meus, gloria quod in genetia Patre, et plenum gratiae veritatis. Deo gratias.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, hail our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this vale of tears. Turn then, most gracious Advocate, thine eyes of mercy toward us, and after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. O God, who art our refuge and our strength, look down in mercy on thy people who cry to thee, by the intercession of the glorious and blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, of thy blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, and of all thy saints. In mercy, goodness, hear our prayers for the conversion of sinners, and for the liberty and exaltation of our Holy Mother, the Church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Holy Michael, Archangel, defend us in the day of battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray, and do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust down to hell Satan and all wicked spirits who wander through the world for the ruin of souls. Amen. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy upon us. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy upon us. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy upon us. May St. Athanasius of Alexandria, Bishop and Doctor of the Church, pray for us. St. Catherine of Stedding, pray for us. St. Wilfrid of York, pray for us. St. Richard of Chichester, pray for us. St. Rowena of Alfriston, pray for us. Our Lady of Walsingham, pray for us. Our Holy Guardian Angels, pray for us. Our Heavenly Patron Saints, pray for us. Our Lady, Queen of Heaven, all the angels and saints, pray for us.